Okay, I got the heads up to go. So I want to welcome everybody today. As you can see, there are some changes and some big things afoot. So before we begin, I first of all want to have you each turn to one another and say hello. But maybe I need to introduce several of the newer people in the back in particular. We have a whole new group in the back today, and we're very happy to have them here from Call to Care, but they came from a long ways from Haiti. So we are very glad to have them here. So we have Paul. So Paul, can you wave your hands, everybody? That's Paul. And Asher, okay. And Aaliyah, there we go. And Miesling. Thank you. And Scylla, we're very happy to have them. And then we have Judy and Doug, okay? And we have Dawn and Tony. And up front, we have John. So we welcome John today. So we have a whole group of new people today. So would everybody turn and extend signs? Oh, two other people, I forgot. I'm so sorry, and they're the first ones I should have introduced. Leo and Nancy, and they're from Call to Care. So I think, oh, and I got two others I didn't notice, so I need to get names. So tell me.
Hi, I'm Emily
Owen.
I work for the
Office
of Christian Church USA.
Oh, wow. Well, we welcome you. So we have lots of guests here today. Oh, and we have another. Okay. Okay, first name again was? Meg. Okay, welcome. So we're going to have to all get together afterwards and have a real get to know you time. So would you turn to one another and extend signs of welcome now to one another? Okay. So we're so glad to have everybody here today. And afterwards, we're going to hear from Call to Care and from our family. So I'm hoping that you'll all stay. We have some watermelon and a few other goodies, and we're going to have just a good time together. So everyone is welcome to stay. Make sure if you, especially since we have so many new people, make sure that you have a bulletin and that you are in a pew with a purple hymn book. And if you don't have either of those two things, would you raise your hands and we'll make sure we get them for you. Okay? You sure? Is there one over there? Okay. Okay. Do we need any more adjustments? Okay. Two other quick announcements pertaining to the service today. One is that we are going to do communion by intinction today. So I will invite at the appropriate time those who are comfortable up, and if you're not, we will bring it back to you. So we will be doing that at communion time. And the second thing, the liturgy today, we have some new responses because we are beginning Season of Peace. So today you will notice a few new responses, but two of them are familiar. The middle one is a little bit new, but it's a very nice one, and we'll be using it for a while. So just so that you're forewarned about that, okay? I want to thank Steve Frost, my husband, for being the liturgist today, so thank you. And we have birthdays. A.J. Briggs' birthday is today, and Karen Dobler's, I think, is 2 days from now, so we're going to sing to Karen today. And Rick Ross's, that's Marion Maxwell's son-in-law's, is this week, too. So can we sing Happy Birthday? flowers today are actually given by Henry and Christine Stevens in memory of Rita Bender, and Christine asked if they could be taken to Marion Maxwell. So since Steve visits, he'll be delivering them to Marion today, so the flowers. Season of Peace begins today and will culminate on Worldwide Communion Sunday on October 1st. And we will be taking the Peace in the Global Witness offering at that time. The office will be closed tomorrow for Labor Day, but downstairs there are some congregational self-studies, hard copies on the table. I'm not sure Samantha got them sent out by email, so I will make sure that happens today. But we do have hard copies on the table, so grab one, and discussion on that in 2 weeks, on 17th, that is 2 weeks, yes. And then Christian Fellowship meets this week at 3 o'clock. Next week, we have our church picnic and rally day, so I'm hoping to see lots of people here. I don't think I'll do it the way you guys are used to, but you're prepared, so come and have fun next week, okay? Any further announcements? Yes, Natalie. Oh dear, okay. Any further announcements? Let us come together in prayer. Dear Lord, we know that you are here, but we invite you into this time with us today, knowing that your Spirit is ever present, that you have told us that you are ever with us. And we pray for that guidance today in all that we hear and say, that it will be a blessed time of fellowshipping together, of taking a look at hard issues, but of also being able to find ways to move forward. We lift this to you as we worship you. Amen.
Our call to worship. God calls us each by name as we gather on holy ground. We come to this place seeking to know the great I am. Let us worship God. Let us pray together. Gracious God, though you are known by many names and depicted in many ways, we know you most fully in Jesus Christ, our Messiah, your Son. We thank you for forming us into the church, the body of Christ in the world. Help us to live as he taught us, loving you, loving neighbor, unified in Christ, using our varied gifts and skills in service of ministry until all things are transformed into what is good and acceptable and perfect. In Christ's name, we ask it. Amen. Our first hymn is number 378, We Wait the Peaceful Kingdom.
Jesus Christ overcame evil with good so that all people might be saved from sin. So let us then confess our need for grace, confident of God's forgiveness. Let us pray our prayer of confession together. Sometimes it sounds too hard. Deny ourselves, take up our crosses, lose our lives. Forgive us, Savior. But we'd rather you do it for us. Forgive us, Christ, but we are overwhelmed with what you ask of us. We long to see you come in glory, but fear the road we must take. Have mercy on our weakness, be patient with our stumbling, and do not leave us behind, even when we are slow to follow, and lead us in your ways of peace. And let us all say, Amen. Christ does not abandon us, but died for us, was raised for us, and loves us still. This is the good news that prevails. In Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, we are forgiven. God has received us, pardoned us, and loved us. So let us forgive one another in love and share the peace of Christ. So peace be with all of you.
And also with you.
Would you turn to one another and extend those signs of peace to one another? As you are able, you may stand.
Our prayer of illumination. Lord our God, we are listening for your word. We are looking for your light. By the power of the Holy Spirit, renew our minds and our hearts so we may discern your will and respond in faith. Amen. Our first scripture reading today comes to us from Isaiah 11, verses 1 through 9. The peaceful kingdom. A root shall come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge for the poor and decide with equity for the oppressed of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion will feed together, and the little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. The second reading comes from Romans 12, 9 through 18, marks of the true Christian. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Persevere in prayer and contribute to the needs of the saints. Pursue hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be arrogant, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take it thought for what is noble in sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. The word of the Lord.
Would they like to come up or not? I don't want them to feel uncomfortable, so they're welcome to do whatever they would like. So. You can come where you can see the book. Okay. So Aaliyah, you want to move right over here. Asher, you want to kind of move in. And Paul, you might want to get a little closer so you can see. Okay. Now, I looked up, and I believe that in your language that you're used to, Asher, can you say that word for me? How do you say it? La peace. But this is your word, I think, isn't it? La paix? Did I say it right? I don't know. Did I say it right? Have you ever heard the word before? La paix? Say it. La paix. Is that right? Okay. See, you have to teach me. That's what I'm asking, okay? So, your word, la paix, is our word, peace. And that's why you saw a lot of people making these signs. We call these la paix signs or peace signs, okay? For peace, okay? I'm going to be talking a little bit more about peace in the sermon today, but this has some nice pictures. Did I say it right or wrong? Oh, good, good. Thank you. Thank you, Silla. Because that's what I'm not good at, so I need somebody who's good at it. Okay. Peace is a hello, a smile, a hug. Can you see? Hugs and smiles. Peace can be bold or quiet and snug. Okay. Peace is pronouncing your friend's name correctly. Something I need to learn to do, right? Make sure I say your names correctly. Peace means we talk to each other directly. We talk to each other. Peace can begin with a laugh and a wave and grow into actions remarkably brave. Peace comes from giving. Far more than you take. It's something we work toward. It's something we make. Takes some work, right? Have any of you grown a garden before? Mm-hmm. Took lots of work, didn't it? Yeah. Peace is on purpose. Peace is a choice. Peace lets the smallest of us have a voice. A voice, right? Peace follows the words, I'm sorry. We can let differences live. It spreads and strengthens when hearts can forgive. Oh, this is cute. Peace is a pillow that softens our sleep. Peace pulls us through darkness or up from the deep. Peace is old like the stars and new as a birth. And then, and if we embrace it, peace cradles the earth. And this opens up, and you can see a whole bunch of pictures. Okay. Let us pray. Can we take hands and pray? Okay. Dear Jesus, we love you. We know you love us. You want us to be one big family. Help us to get along, to love one another. Amen. Okay. Thank you all very much. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I'm learning a lot. Today we begin the season of peace, and what we're concentrating on today is called the peaceful kingdom. Romans 12:18 says, if it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Well, this season of peace is a time set aside to both define and deepen our calling as peacemakers. So with the intent of defining what it means to be a peacemaker, we're going to begin with that word peace. So what is peace? Well, if you look it up in the dictionary, the Merriam-Webster dictionary defines peace as a state of tranquility or quiet, as when a place is peaceful, or the state of one's mind is at peace. Another use of the word is to represent the absence of war or conflict, as when warring countries sign a treaty, or when friends make up. But biblical peace is more than just the absence of conflict or a state of rest. It means completeness or wholeness, and it points to the presence of something else. Well, the Hebrew word for peace is shalom. One of the first uses of this root of shalom is shalom, and it's used in the book of Exodus in chapters 21 and 22. In these two chapters, Moses provides instructions for the Israelite people about what to do if someone causes a material loss or if there is a theft of property. The idea is that when a loss or injury occurs, the owner is lacking or incomplete. The one responsible is supposed to make things right. So the word shalom means to make it good, or make full restitution, or to restore. In other words, to make something whole. But this doesn't mean just the restoration of things that were lost or stolen. The word has an overall sense of fullness and completeness in mind, body, and estate. Well, I did a lot of Googling in the internet this week, which led me to many different articles on peace and what it means. But eventually, I came to an article that was written by an Andrew Latham on just peace theory. And what interested me was his definition. Latham explains that the concept of just peace theory rests on a specific understanding of the word peace. Rather than the opposite of war, Latham says that just peace theory describes a social condition of harmony, wholeness, completeness, prosperity, welfare, and tranquility. And he goes on to say, and I quote, "It is a state of social well-being in which all relationships between humanity, God, and creation are justly ordered and in which the basic needs of people are met. Violence, then, is viewed as a manifestation of evil that prevents people from meeting their basic needs or that undermines the social structures and relationships necessary for human flourishing," unquote. Latham's description of just peace agrees with what the prophet Isaiah called the peaceful kingdom. Isaiah prophesies a future time when all will experience peace and harmony. Isaiah 2 uses the word justice. The Hebrew word translated righteousness means justice. Eugene Peterson in his Message Bible paraphrases Isaiah by saying, "The king won't judge by appearances, won't decide on the basis of hearsay. He'll judge the needy by what is right and render decisions on earth's poor with justice." In the Old Testament, kings were supposed to emulate and execute God's law, God's loyal justice. And some did this better than others. In Isaiah's future peaceful kingdom, the king, or as Christians understand it, Jesus Christ, will render judgments that are just, which will promote peace and harmony. Harmony can be used to describe a pattern of relationships within a social group or between individuals and their social context. And in this passage, Isaiah addresses this pattern of relationships between the earth's poor and needy and those described as wicked, probably those who have abused the system or power unjustly, thus requiring justice. Or as Latham says, those who have undermined the social structures and relationships necessary for human flourishing. Isaiah also envisions a world of opposites living together in peace and harmony, a world turned upside down. We know that a wolf would not live with a lamb. A lamb is a food source for a wolf. Or figuratively, someone who was a wolf would devour one who was a lamb. We know that hunters like leopards feed on the young or the innocent. We also know that children are not usually considered leaders. Isaiah goes on, but what I want to point out is why. Isaiah believes this will happen because all will have the knowledge of the Lord. Again, Eugene Peterson paraphrases this part of the passage by saying, "Neither animal nor human will hurt or kill on my holy mountain. The whole earth will be brimming with knowing God alive, a living knowledge of God ocean deep, ocean wide." Peterson adds something that I find important. He says that the whole earth will be brimming with knowing God alive. This speaks to relationship with God. Everyone's relationships will be affected by their relationship, by their knowing God alive. Peace starts with God. The Apostle Paul outlines what the marks of a true Christian are. And like Isaiah's image of the peaceful kingdom, Paul makes it clear that Christians are to reflect God's character in every part of their life. Paul tells us to live in harmony, not to be haughty. We are not to repay evil for evil. We are to try to live peacefully with all, or peaceably with all. 3 months before his death in June of 1963, Pope John XXIII wrote a document called Peace on Earth. And in this document, Pope John said that peace on earth cannot be established, never guaranteed, except by the diligent observance of the divinely established order. Pope John understands this order to be placed by God in those created in God's image, or in human beings' hearts. In the letter to the Romans, Paul concentrates on social relationships. And much like the Apostle Paul, Pope John affirms that peace on earth is connected to the love of neighbor, to our social relationships. These relationships emulate our relationship with God. He says, and I quote, "Human society demands that we be guided by justice, respect the rights of others, and be animated by such love as will make us feel the needs of others as our own, and induce us to share our good with others, and to strive in the world to make all of us alike heirs to the noblest of intellectual and spiritual values," unquote. In his article on just peace theory, Latham takes this a step further and reinforces that just peace isn't just about individual social relationships. Remembering that Latham wrote that just peace was a state of social well-being in which all relationships between humanity, God, and creation are justly ordered, and in which the basic needs of people are met, Latham asserts that institutions and cultural norms or habits can interfere with this just order and with the meeting of the basic needs of people. Latham says, "Institutions and cultural norms may be political in nature, having to do with the direct oppression of groups or peoples through state power, but they may also be economic in nature, taking the form of unjust systems of economic organization that systematically redistribute wealth in ways that harm people by preventing them from meeting their basic needs," unquote. From this, I think we can all agree that the peace in peacemaking doesn't mean tranquility or lack of war, but it gets at a deeper realization that peace and justice are linked. You can have peace and not have justice. Look at the occupation, or look at any occupation, or even at the Roman occupation that kept its Pax Romana, or the peace of Rome, by military might. This may be peace in some sense of the word, but it's not just peace. Andrew Latham follows along this same line when he says, "From a just peace perspective, there is an intimate and inescapable link between peace and justice. The nature of this link is captured most pithily in Pope Paul the VI's phrase, 'If you want peace, work for justice.'" In an afterword to their book, Peace, Miranda and Baptiste Paul, that was the book I read to our young disciples today, state that peace can begin with a small step that you choose. A smile might spark a friendship. A friendship fosters empathy, and empathy leads to helpful actions, and helpful actions over time bring justice and peace. Devastation from climate change, human trafficking, structural and environmental racism, these are issues we know hurt people around the world. But we have a God whose presence empowers the church to become advocates and agents of God's shalom, of wholeness and redemption in the world today. And as Miranda and Baptiste affirm, peace begins with one small step of your choosing. Let us pray together. Help us, O God, to put your faith into action, to not only talk about peace, but to put peace into our daily practice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue as we respond to God's word through the singing of Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, 753. Michael, are there any prayers online? Okay.
Margaret Embry is asking for healing prayers for her injuries in a recent accident.
Thank you.
And I also would like to ask for prayers for my neighbor, Dom, who we've been hearing about. He's returned home to basically just spend his remaining days with his family. He's run out of options at this point.
Thank you. Do I have any other prayers from the congregation? Okay. Let us pray together as God's people. God, our creator, redeemer, and sustainer, as we begin this season of peace, make us more aware of our interactions with our world around us and help to both show us and give us opportunities to be your peacemakers in a world in need of your shalom, your wholeness, and completeness. To that end, we take our first step today in prayer, praying for shalom, justice, and peace for those who have or are experiencing violence of any kind, gang and gun, genocide, killings, political unrest, civil war, war, and to this end, we lift up Darfur and Libya, Sudan and Niger, Ethiopia and Ukraine, Russia and Haiti, Palestine and Israel, Ecuador, as well as our own country and any others. We pray for recovery for those who have survived natural disasters, the loss of homes, life, family, and friends, fires in Canada and fire in Maui, rain in California, and those in the path of the most recent hurricanes, Hillary and Idalia. We continue to lift up the countries of Turkey, Syria, and others who seek to recover from earthquakes. Help us, even as we pray for others, to realize your promise that despite the uncertainty of life, we will fear no evil, for we proclaim that you are with us. Sustain our God, transform our hearts and minds, and help us to be more like Jesus, caring for the least of these. We continue our prayers for Dom and for Mark, for Donna, for Lisa Barrett's son, for Bethany and for Deb, for Shannon and for Joe, for Lori and Kay, for Kay and Aaron, for James and Glenn and Todd and Richard, for William and Douglas, Christine and Wanda, Lisa and Sandy, Becky and David, Steve and Linda, Barb and Janine, Caitlin and Kathy, David and Bev, Jan and Allison, Nancy and Shirley, Kara and Freddie, Kristen and Kelly, and Janine King, John, Deanna Side, Sheldon, Ellen and Mike Hopkins, Barb Miller, Daniel Allerton, and Carol Hubright, Suzanne Spanadakis, Margaret Emery, and Family Promise Families. We pray for those who are caregivers and to those needing care, and we lift up Jean and Paul Salisbury, and Kay and Dale, Thelma Vermeulen and Barb Chapel, Bonnie and Thurlow, and Ed and Cheryl, Barbara Bruner and Eileen Berm, Marion Maxwell, Jim and Ann Peck, and Lynn Blodgett. We pray for those who grieve and ask for your shalom, the peace that is found only in you, to be extended to friends and family of Jerry Silowa and Barbara Diesering, for Yao and Mark Simon, for Marilyn Wilson and John on the loss of their friend and mother Ann Hooper, and for Judy Leone and her family on the loss of her brother David Porter, for the friends and family of Shirley May, and for Suzanne Bowens and the family of Hazel Washburn, and for the friends and family of Caroline Patchett. We ask this in Jesus' name, and we join our voices in the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us give as God has so abundantly given to us. Sing it. We'll try it, okay? You might want to look at the words in the book, though. We I'm doing this off the cuff, so Anne, I hope you don't mind. When it's time to do the intinction, would you mind coming up and taking one side while I take the other? Would that be okay? Okay, thanks. This is where Susan needed her glasses. Friends, this is a joyful feast. It'll be the first time that we've done it this way, I think, since before COVID, so this is wonderful. The people of God. People will come from north and south and from east and west and will sit at table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and he blessed and broke it, and he gave it to them, and then their eyes were opened, and it was then that they recognized him. This is the Lord's table, and our Savior invites those who trust him to share the feast which he has prepared. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise to you, O God, for all of your works. You created the world and called it good and made us in your image to live together in love. You made a covenant with us, and even when we turn from you, you remained ever faithful. Therefore, with the saints of every age, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Thank you, O God, for sending us your Son. He lived among us and told your story. He healed the sick and welcomed sinners. He shared our pain and died our death, and then rose to new life that we might live and all creation be restored. We give thanks that on the night of his arrest, Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this, remembering me." So remembering your boundless love revealed to us in Jesus Christ, we break bread and share the cup, giving ourselves to you to live for him in joy and in praise. Remembering our Lord's self-giving love, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. And gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us the body and the blood of Christ, and that we may be his body for the world. By your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with one another until we feast with him and with all your saints in the eternal realm of justice and peace. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And let us all say, Amen. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. So what I'm going to ask is for Anne to come up, and we're going to form two. One of us will be at one end and one at the other. So if you kind of separate yourselves and as you are able, come forward. And those who are not able, we will bring it to you. Okay? And don't let me forget Kay. Welcome to them. Would you join in the prayer at the end of communion? Gracious God, we thank you for this special day, not only because we celebrate communion in the table that you set for us, but for the reminder that we are invited to your table with our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world. Let it be a table of peace for all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our final hymn is Oh for a World, 372. And now, go in peace to love and serve. We take up our cross to follow in the way of Jesus our Lord. The blessing of God be with you, the love of Jesus fill you, and the power of the Holy Spirit sustain you now and forever. And let us all say, Amen.